All right, hello everybody. Thank you for waiting a few minutes. We just wanted to make sure that we had everyone join us who is going to be attending tonight. I'd like to welcome you to Books and Ideas, Our Vanishing Glaciers with Doreen Vanderstoop and Bob Sandford. My name is Amanda and I'm a librarian with Calgary Public Library. I will be your host for this evening. I'd like to begin our program with a land acknowledgement. At Calgary Public Library, we acknowledge the ancestral and traditional Indigenous territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy, Siksika, Tsiyatabi, the Siksika, the Bagani, the Gani, and the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta, which includes the Tsuut'ina and Ayaha Nakoda nations of Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Morley. The city of Calgary, Mokinstis, is also home to Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3. Now, if this is the first time that you've used Zoom, I'll just give you a little bit of information about some features that you may wish to know about tonight. We will be having a Q&A at the end of the discussion, so I would invite you to message me on the chat with any questions that you may have for Doreen and Bob. The chat function is at the bottom of the page in the middle of the screen, and it just says chat on it. You can also message me if you're having any problems with the technology, and hopefully I'll be able to resolve that for you. If you are removed from the Zoom meeting for whatever reason and you're not able to return, please do call our library hotline at 403-260-2600 and they may help you resolve that. I will also let you know that tonight's session will be recorded. However, we have asked that everyone keep their mics muted and their video off, so you will not be included in that recording. So this evening is very exciting. It is our first session of Books and Ideas. This is one of many new programs that we developed while we were all working hard from home during quarantine. And we hope that this will help meet some of the programming gap that's been left through our social distancing. Books and Ideas is a new program that aims to bring together Calgary authors to discuss exciting and wide-ranging ideas that are relevant to all of the people in our city. We are very lucky this evening to have Doreen Vanderstoop and Bob Sandford as our first guests. So I would like to introduce this evening's presenters. Bob Sandford holds the Global Water Futures Chair in Water and Climate Security at the United Nations University Institute for Water, Environment, and Health. In this capacity, Bob was the co-author of the UN Water in the World We Want report on post-2015 Global Sustainable Development Goals relating to water. He is also lead author of Canada in the Global World, a new United Nations report, or expert report, examining the capacity of Canada's water sector to meet and help others meet the United Nations 2030 Transforming Our World Water-Related Sustainable Development Goals. Our Vanishing Glaciers, The Snows of Yesteryear, and the Future Climate of the Mountain West recently won the prestigious $10,000 Lane Anderson Award for the Best Science Writing in Canada in 2017. Quenching the Dragon, the China-Canada Water Crisis was published by Rocky Mountain Books in the fall of 2018. His latest books, Rain Coming Down and the Anthropocene Disruption, were published in 2019. Now, throughout the program, I will be sharing links to these books and others in the chat, so please do check that. Many of them, if not all of them, are available through the Calgary Public Library's website. Doreen Vanderstoop is a Calgary-based writer, storyteller, and musician. Her short fiction has been published by Prairie Fire and Loft on 8th, and has appeared online at the Montreal Siri, Prairie Journal, Epiphany Magazine, and others. As a storyteller musician, she intersperses songs amongst tales of all genres, including her own original stories. Doreen performs for audiences of all ages at schools, libraries, festivals, conferences, and more. She leads workshops to ignite in others a passion for the power of story, oral and written. Doreen's debut novel, Watershed, was published by Freehand Books in May. And for those of you who have not yet had the opportunity to read Watershed, I'd like to remind you that we do have copies in the Calgary Library Collection, and it's being sold by our wonderful independent bookstores around Calgary as well. Watershed is a story about a family struggling in southern Alberta against the catastrophic effects of climate change. It's 2058 and the glaciers in the mountain west have melted away. The story alternates between two perspectives. Willa Van Bruggen fights to keep her ancestral land alive while her son, Daniel Brooks, goes to work for the Crown Corporation building a water pipeline to the south. While Daniel has his own dragons to slay, Willa is losing everything she holds dear, her farm, her son, even her grip on reality. Watershed explores the human costs of climate change and the strength of forgiveness, adaptation, and family bonds. Before I turn it over to our speakers, I'll just remind you once more to please send me any questions directly that you may have for them that they will answer at the end of this session. And with that, I would like to welcome you both. We're so pleased to have you with us tonight, and I will leave the discussion for you for the next hour, but I did want to kick things off with a question. So you clearly both share an interest and concern about our Rocky Mountain glaciers. And I'm curious, what sparked your fascination with this topic?
Shall I start? Okay, thank you so much, Amanda. And I just want to take a moment to thank you and the amazing Rosemary Griebel at the library for making this program possible. And Bob, it's wonderful to be here with you. So it's a thrill for me to be doing this program with you. So where does my love for glaciers come from? Well, my family reveled in the mountains when we immigrated to Canada from the Netherlands in 1968. My parents took us camping and hiking every chance they got. And some of our favorite places were Bow Lake, which of course is filled by Bow Glacier Falls, Takaka Falls. We used to love camping at Chancellor Peak along Kicking Horse River. And like so many visitors to the Rockies, we marveled at the fact that these falls and rivers spilled from these huge slabs of ice that were sitting atop towering peaks. So as an adult, my love of glaciers, of course, has continued, and I have climbed higher and higher. I was very lucky last year to be able to go to Icefall Lodge in BC, and I hiked to an overlook of Lyell Glacier, massive, monstrous, amazing glacier. But one of my very favorites is actually accessible from two different points along the Icefields Parkway. One of them is Parker Ridge. I've looked down on Saskatchewan Glacier many times from Parker Ridge, but I've also looked at it on an approach to the toll. And it's just one of my favorite places to go. But I'd like to turn it over to you now, Bob, because coincidentally, it's also one of your favorite places, but you've had a much more up close and personal encounter with this glacier than I did.
Well, thank you very much, Doreen. Yes, I have been up close and personal with glacial ice, and I've written about it in our Vanishing Glaciers. And I must admit that I came to know the Saskatchewan Glacier entirely by accident. And I should explain from the outset, however, that it was an accident of inexperience and incompetence, and it's only by virtue of youthful good luck, which many of us are fortunate to have, that I live to tell about it. And it all began innocently enough, as these things do, after viewing a dizzying array of mountain climbing photographs projected on the wall of the Warden Station I was at by a friend. I decided that I wanted to become a mountaineer, and of course there's no point in half measures. The first backpacking trip I did in my entire life was across the Columbia Icefield. And I only had 2 days off, but in my opinion, that ought to have been enough. I mean, when you're 20, how big can a glacier or an ice field be? And the accident happened while we were descending the Saskatchewan Glacier in the afternoon of the second day. And I was so tired I'd given up trying to avoid the big meltwater streams that course across the glacier's broken surface. And I was cold and I was wet and I was worn out. And all I wanted to do was get down, so I took a shortcut. And unless you've traveled on the surface of a big glacier, it's hard to imagine how much melt can occur in a hot day. There are actually rivers on the surface of the ice, and seeking a direct line, I tried to cross one. And the power of the icy water lifted me up, carried me to the mouth of a huge crevasse. One moment I was looking at the sun sparkle of water, and a moment later I was in the center of a waterfall, plunging into complete darkness beneath the ice. And the waterfall cascaded down a series of ice lips to join the river that flowed beneath the glacier. And never before or since have I heard coming from everywhere around me, so many of the different sounds that water makes. And here I was inside a planetary artery, examining firsthand what water does to the world. But I had this problem. Only a few inches separated the top of the water and the roof of the ice. And in darkness, I kept smashing into boulders and scraping against the underside of the glacier. But just as shock and wonder were beginning to evaporate, the strangest thing happened. The ice above began to glow, and at faint, it was a faint green. And as the river swept me onward, the glow intensified. Green gradually merged into a pale blue. And then I noticed that rocks were hanging down from a ceiling made entirely of light. And then I washed out of the glacier into the sunshine, into the full flood of the North Saskatchewan River, where I should submit that my problems really began. So accidents do change us, and this accident changed everything. My life flowed toward unexpected ends. And I realize now that I have spent the rest of my life trying to prevent my culture from carrying me permanently downstream and away from the luminous glory of that subglacial light. And my book, Our Vanishing Glaciers, is really a testament to how much that experience shaped my identity and how important the Columbia Icefield and glaciers remain in the life and work of so many who care about the remarkable character of Canada's Mountain West.
Wow, that's an incredible story. I am so glad you lived to tell the tale. And the next time I'll go back to Saskatchewan Glacier and I look down from Parker Ridge, I'm going to have a whole new reason to look at it with awe. So
don't do what I did.
I will definitely not do what you did. Of course, the main reason that you and I are here tonight talking about all of this is because climate change is a major threat to our glacial reservoirs. And as I mentioned at my book launch, it was Margaret Atwood who really provided the impetus for me to get my novel done. I'd been writing Watershed for about 5 years by this point, and I'd been doing contract writing in between, and of course there were the happy demands of life with my husband and two boys. But then I read that Margaret Atwood had appeared at a literary festival in Barrie, Ontario, in a high school, and she talked about Al Gore's An Inconvenient Truth, and she talked about the importance of this issue of climate change. And she asked the question, where are all the Canadian writers writing about this critical issue of our time? And that was my clarion call. So as a fiction writer, I tried to build a world that in the novel that I hoped would be relatable and plausible. Of course, to help me do that, I read a lot. Margaret Atwood's Mad Adams series, of course, but also some of the Alberta great writers that I love so much. Dr. David Schindler, I read many articles by him. He's a leading water specialist like you, Bob. And then books by Andrew Nikiforuk and Kevin Van Tegem, Aretha Van Herk, Fred Stenson, Sid Marty. They all write so beautifully about this place that we love, this province of ours. But the backbone of my research on glaciers and water were your books, Bob. And honestly, I am not fawning when I say that you are my hero. I have just always found that you write articulately, you write passionately, and you write prolifically about water science. And that helped me a great deal in trying to project this story onto the future. So this cli-fi genre, this climate fiction, it seems to be gaining momentum. There's more and more of us writing in that style. What are your thoughts on that genre, Bob?
Well, first, thank you very much, Doreen. I've been interested in the cli-fi genre since it emerged, and I've read everything I can find. Now, most of it, however, is about other places and circumstances. Some books, like Barbara Kingsolver's Haunting Flight Behavior, are memorable because they projected very credible futures based on the climate science with which I was becoming familiar. And of course, like so many others, I literally inhale Margaret Atwood's books, all of them, and her poetry also, right from the beginning. But there hasn't been much that deals with landscapes that I knew well and people with whom I could relate directly. And what drew me irresistibly to your book was that here for the first time was a cli-fi novel about the very region in which I live. And the novels, the characters in the novel are locals with whom I can relate directly. And the climate science upon which the plot turns is science I know, and the future scenarios projected in the novel are more than credible. And for these reasons, Watershed was, for me, electrifying. So I want to ask you, though, Doreen, are you more or less concerned about climate change after writing Watershed?
Well, the short answer is more, definitely. Of course, the reason you recognize the science is because I read your books, so that helps a lot. We have a lot in common there. But I have to say that the seeds of my concern go actually quite far back. So even though we lived in Calgary when we moved from the Netherlands to Canada, we lived in Calgary the whole time. I remember as a young girl hoping every spring, listening to those weather reports every spring and hoping that farmers would have just enough water and just enough, you know, sunlight to grow their crops and raise their animals. And so that just kind of combined with the climate change issue, which then became more and more of a staple in the news cycle. And so then that kind of led me to the what if question. So what would happen to the farmers if all the glaciers were gone and there was no more water, you know, pouring through southern Alberta? What would the farmers do? So that's definitely when my concern about this all intensified, particularly as I was reading your books. So it was hard to read, but of course very interesting and of course very illuminating. So because you've written so many of them, I'm really curious if your concerns about climate change grew as you were writing your 30 plus books.
Well, I have profound concerns about climate change that have been constructed, as you pointed out, brick by brick by thousands of peer-reviewed studies over many decades. And Watershed affirmed and deepened those concerns. The literary arts offer a different way of understanding what the science is telling us. Writers tell the climate story through story and can project the impacts it could have on specific people and their families in a specific place and in ways that science can't. And the glacial recession science you put forward in Watershed is very credible. The melting of snow in the spring and the melting of glaciers in the summer has provided water security for much of the West, including the prairies, which in places are so dry, they contribute no water to local rivers. And not enough of snow is falling in our now warming winters, and too much of it's melting away during hotter summers to sustain our mountain glaciers. And if you consider glacial ice as water in the bank, so to speak, we don't have as much as we thought, and it's disappearing far faster than we could ever imagine. And research demonstrates just how rapidly our climate is warming. Through the efforts of the IP3 research group and the Western Canadian Cryospheric Network, we now know that we may have lost as many as 300 glaciers in the Rocky Mountains alone between 1920 and 2005. So the point I'd like to leave with our audience is that the hydrology of the Canadian West is changing, and it's changing fast. And it should be noted that the loss of glacial ice is a symptom of a much larger problem. The same warming that is causing our glaciers to disappear so quickly is reducing snowpack and the duration and extent of snow cover throughout the Mountain West. And snowpack and snow cover have been declining by 17% per decade. So the plot line in Watershed in this regard is utterly valid. The Great Plains will be an epicenter of change. Under current circumstances, mean warming on the prairies could be as much as 9 degrees Celsius later this century. And by mid-century, the Canadian West could be changed by this as much as it was by European settlement. And I also thought, very interesting how you played with the science too. I have to admit, at first I thought the idea that a pipeline that once carried oil to the West Coast was now carrying desalinated water from the Pacific to the parched interior. I kind of thought that was a little far-fetched. But you know, our climate group talked about this, a climate science group talked about it, and we concluded it wasn't as far-fetched as it may have seemed. By the 2050s, the time in which the pot of watershed unfolds, it's not impossible we could have made desalination a lot more efficient and a lot less environmentally damaging as well as cheaper. With respect to pipelines, well, we pipe oil over entire continents. Why not water? And if you've been to California, we already know that we're doing some pretty amazing things now. And I can't imagine what we'll be doing in the 2050s when as much as 40% of the world's population is projected to be water scarce. But it's also important to know that projecting climate change into the future is complicated, and I'm sure you figured that out writing your novel. And your book demonstrates two things that are very important in understanding climate change effects. The first is that there is a time lag between when the concentration of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is dramatically increased, as it has been particularly over the last 50 years, and the actual appearance fully of the effects of that change. And what that means is that at first the changes can seem benign or even somewhat beneficial in terms of, say, more moderate winters, for example, at higher latitudes. And you really captured that. Can you read that section?
Sure. So in this section, Willa and Calvin's son Daniel has just been born. So Willa and Daniel are the two main characters. So this is a time when it's the time of the floods. There's lots of water happening everywhere at this point. So I'll read. As Willa lowered Daniel into the kitchen sink for his bath one early September morning, her heart sang. His pudgy palms slapped the water. Sunshine streamed through the window. She glanced outside, drinking in the unbroken blue sky. The tree-studded foothills gently rose and fell. The mosaic of a million greens lay over the Van Bruggen Ranch and beyond. The shelter belt of lodgepole pines glittered in the sunlight. Their thickly needled branches waved in the breeze. In the field beyond the barn, cattle lumbered through tall timothy grass, attacking their lunch with vigor. Willa grinned down at her baby boy. The thick corn silk hair that had sprouted on his head reminded her of a western pasque flower gone to seed. After gently patting him dry, she tucked him into a fleece sleeper. Life bulged with the presence of ample water. Yes, glaciers ebbed away each year in overflowing rivers, and sometimes too much rain fell. But all that could be tolerated, managed, appreciated even in a fecund world whose ever-warming springs and autumns stretched the growing season. Newborn calves had no trouble surviving when the wind blew mild and the ground wore a shroud of morning frost instead of tall snowdrifts. They'd been able to stagger their cattle breeding over a longer period to spread out the calving season. Land that could be seeded grew plentiful crops, reaped with ease under a balmy harvest moon in December.
Like that passflower analogy too. Thank you very much, Doreen. And what I find also interesting about your novel is you've understood that as time passes and the composition of the Earth's atmosphere changes, you discover that a warmer global atmosphere doesn't just mean pleasant changes. Changes can occur fast. For every degree Celsius of warming the atmosphere can carry, it can carry 7% more water vapor. And that means far more turbulent weather, more powerful storms that could put great stress on people and their families. And it also means the greater likelihood of a deep and persistent drought. And one of the most powerful elements of this novel is how it portrays how stress associated with prolonged drought interspersed with extreme weather events wears on people. And there is one passage in the book that makes this point unforgettable. Could you read that?
Sure. At its core, Watershed really is a story about family and how external stressors like climate change can really affect family dynamics. So this excerpt jumps back in time now to when Willa is a young girl. So this is the 2020s, and these were really called the flood years. Young Willa stretched her arms across the wall of sandbags and peered into the rising Old Man River. She should have been milking the Holstein Dolly. Instead, she stood glaring at the roiling, muddy waters that had ruined her 13th birthday. Papa and Mama and her 10-year-old sister Sophie hadn't even sung happy birthday to her. Her ears had been filled the whole day with the roar of a backhoe engine and the slap, slap of sandbags being piled one on top of the other. The river had turned on them again, slobbering into their lives as it had every spring for the last 3 years. Still, the disaster of great stormy heat waves turning glaciers into raging rivers didn't make her insides quiver as much as the battle between her mother and father did. Her father said everything would be okay, but Willa couldn't remember the last time she'd seen her mother smile. The other day, her mother had called the ranch a godforsaken, waterlogged piece of land. The glares that shot out of her mother's eyes like lasers made Willa feel like throwing up. Most of the time, Willa's insides just felt heavy, as if her bones were made of stone. She eyed the willows by the river, now swamped by the flood. Swaying wildly in the wind, they looked as if they were trying to lift up their roots and run away as water crept further and further up their trunks. So, as you mentioned before, Bob, the southern prairies are particularly sensitive to climatic conditions, and I certainly found that through my research. I love how the earliest white explorers actually spotlighted this issue. In 1857, John Palliser explored the region and called it an inhospitable desert. In 1880, John McCune came through and declared the region ideally suited to agriculture. Now, Palliser came through during a drought, and McCune came through during a period of unusually heavy rainfall. Of course, I always think if they'd just taken the time to consult with Indigenous people about that, I don't think it would have taken 23 years to put two and two together. So you did comment, Bob, about a watershed being a relatable local story. But, I mean, the research that I've done, too, just shows that it's a much more widespread problem, of course. And I imagine that you know about lots of places in the world where this type of story could take place.
Well, you're quite right. Our situation is not unique. The problem we face here in the prairies with respect to agriculture's great reliance on mountain waters is widespread around the world. And so is the problem of increasingly deep and persistent drought. And a great deal of agriculture in Europe relies, for example, on glacial melt to supply water late in summer when the winter snows are gone. And glaciers in Europe are disappearing at a rate unprecedented in modern times. The same is true in South America, and the glaciers of the Himalayas are the water towers for almost all of Asia. And recent research reveals that glaciers in parts of the Himalayas are disappearing at double the rate we initially thought. And what's important here is that some 500 million people rely on glacial melt to supply water to drink and grow their food. So stay tuned. And as the climate continues to warm and glaciers disappear, water security is clearly going to be a greater and greater issue. And in this regard, the plot line of watershed could be seen as a simulacrum for many other parts of the world and really for the world itself. And you've written also about the complications of managing stress in water insecure areas. And you wrote about the creation of a federal provincial water authority that's taken control of Alberta's water supplies. And in the novel, there's terrific resistance to this. Can you tell us how that became part of the plot?
Sure. So I created a crown corporation in watershed called Crystal, which was to me a compromise between complete commodification of water and treating it strictly as a human right. So just so everybody's on the same page, crown corporations are created when the private sector is unable or unwilling to provide certain services that the government deems necessary. So my idea with this crown corporation was for the narrative to move the needle towards a notion of actual reasonable valuation of the natural resource. So I'm curious, with all your expertise, Bob, so looking into the future, what kind of water management do you foresee as being beneficial for the prairies?
I think you have to understand the history of water management. The Federal Natural Resources Act of 1930 decreed that, except in the cases of fisheries, navigation, transboundary flows, and water quality, management of water fell under provincial and territorial jurisdiction as it does so today. The weakness in our current system is you have 13 different approaches to managing and protecting what is often the same water. So we're weak in integrated watershed management. And more importantly, we're the only G7 country that doesn't have a national flood and drought forecasting system, which requires continental scale monitoring. And it's something we desperately need if we're going to predict and manage the kind of water security issues that drive the novel and the plot in your novel. Your novel accurately portrays the fact that water rights are a very sensitive, contentious issue, especially in southern Alberta, where water is precious and it's already scarce. And 50 years from now, unless our projections are way off, water is even going to be more scarce than it is today. And you clearly understood this, and you framed it well in the novel, in a scene in which the public attends a town hall, and I've been to some of these, where the new water strategy is to be discussed. And perhaps you can tell us about that, maybe read from this most interesting section.
Sure. It does occur to me as you were speaking that in our next federal election, it seems like we should all be asking our candidates about a national flood and drought forecasting system. So maybe that's a little seed we can all plant in our brains to remember.
Well, it would certainly help everyone. It would certainly help farmers, that's for sure.
Absolutely. So yeah, just to go back to the town hall, in Watershed, the Crown Corporation Crystal creates a task force that travels through southern Alberta to explain about the pipeline and where it's going to be built. So the year is now 2058. That's where most of the novel takes place. There's a few flashbacks, but now we're in 2058. Task Force Chair Nancy Weston said, "Albert Travis, can you please explain about the provincial water charter passed by last year by your government?" "I'd be happy to," Albert said. "As you know, the government suspended all provincial water licenses between the 49th and 52nd parallel 3 years ago by a unanimous all-party vote pursuant to the emergency powers provisions of the Water Act of 1999. The charter was passed by the majority government last year as an addendum to the Water Scarcity Bill, which replaced the 1999 Water Act. It outlines the water rights enjoyed by every Albertan." "Enjoyed," snorted a stout man at the end of the line. He laughed at his own interruption. Nancy placed her hand lightly on Albert's arm and stared at the source of the outburst. "Please give Albert a chance to explain." Dan saw Nancy glance casually at the Alberta provincial police officers who subtly straightened their posture. Albert continued. "The system of first-in-time, first-in-right, or FITFER, was instituted to encourage the development of agriculture in the West. It gave priority access to water in times of shortage to the earliest recorded licenses held by those who had struggled as the first pioneers and endured incredible hardships. Now that water resources, even in southern Alberta's deepest aquifers, have dwindled, the FITFER system is obsolete." "Allow me to interject, Albert," Nancy said. "As a federal crown corporation, Crystal is supported by the federal government. The company provides water at cost to Albertans. It's all part of the federal government's national water program. People in parts of the country where water is plentiful subsidize water delivery in places where water is scarce."
Well, I have to say that the idea of suspending established water licenses, well, that'll get the irrigators going for sure. But we have to remember this is a novel. And in Watershed, you also paint a picture of a more northerly Fort McMurray becoming one of the most desirable places to live in Alberta. And you also hold out hope that the damage done there will in time be remediated and that will become a new center of prosperity in the province. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me how you arrived at that plot and perhaps read something from the novel that puts into relief your thinking?
Sure. So as a novelist, it's always fun to turn tropes and generally accepted ideas on their head. The reference to the National Water Program may actually ring certain bells for our listeners. I also liked the idea that the landscape scarred by the tailings from the oil sands operations could be a vital place of reclamation and one of the first places to benefit from the arrival of water through a provincial pipeline. So in this reading, Willa is accompanying her deceased friend's son, Peter, young son, to Fort Mac so he can decide if he wants to live with his relatives there or stay with her and Calvin in southern Alberta. So this passage, again, like most of the book, takes place in 2058, where damage from oil sands development is a serious, lingering problem. Okay, so I'll read. Peter asked an endless string of questions about Fort McMurray and its offerings and listened with rapt attention to his uncle's explanations. Willa didn't think the oil sands museum would hold his interest, but she was wrong. Peter's uncle, Roy Many Horses, accompanied them to the museum the next day. There, he became a passionate tour guide at the before, during, and after oil sands landscape display. Oil was the lifeblood of Alberta for over 100 years. Pipelines crisscrossed North America from coast to coast, he said, but it all came at a huge cost. Peter drank in the narrative. Roy continued, the land bore the brunt of this thirst for oil sands crude. Groundwater contamination, greenhouse gas emissions, high concentrations of heavy metals and arsenic in traditional First Nations food like muskrat, duck, and moose. One study found high levels of mercury in birds' eggs in the Athabasca River Basin. He pointed to a 3D display showing the migration of contaminants in groundwater from Fort McMurray to the Mackenzie River. Every last penny of the mine financial security program, Roy continued, has been used to reclaim the land here and downstream on the Athabasca, and more will be needed. Project closure costs far outstrip the security collected over the years to cover the environmental liability. In 2018, the Alberta Energy Regulator estimated cleanup costs for the province's oil industry would total $58 billion. The actual amount to date is $260 billion. After the museum, they drove to one of the reclamation sites for a helicopter tour of the operations area. Roy's voice came through the headset. This is the Milton Lake Settling Basin. We are in the process of reclaiming the site using a process of solidification and stabilization of the tailings. We add a mixture of cement and other compounds. Once it hardens, we'll top it with soil and plant trees. A site in Sydney, Nova Scotia called the Sydney Tar Ponds was cleaned up this way 45 years ago, and the long-term results are positive. We've already reclaimed other smaller sites around here. The museum we went to sits on an old tailings pond. Milton Lake is the biggest my company has tackled so far. Willa looked down at the enormous expanse of black sludge. How much concrete compound will it take to harden this lake, she asked. At least 200,000 cubic meters, Roy answered. That's roughly five times as much concrete as they used to build the CN Tower in Toronto. So I'm really curious, Bob, since you were talking about Fort McMurray, what your reaction was when you first read that?
Well, first of all, I have to say that the value of a rip-roaring cli-fi novel like Watershed can reside in the possibilities it may invite for positive change to avoid a dystopian future. And the plot of Watershed revolves around a mean warming of 4 degrees Celsius globally. And our latest projections are that with a 4 degrees Celsius of mean warming, the planet would likely only be able to support a billion people. The climate change projections for Fort McMurray are such that a water pipeline from the coast notwithstanding, if these projections come to pass, we will see that region have essentially the same climate as Medicine Hat, in which case diverting water south from whatever was flowing in the Athabasca River might also be a consideration. And for this reason, I'm making Fort McMurray the new center of prosperity and sustainability, for me, was a bit of a stretch. But now it's a novel, you know, and why not imagine it? Why not think about it? Why not look at it and enjoy the fun of thinking differently? And personally, I would give anything to prevent the kind of future that presently appears on the horizon for Fort McMurray's oil sands lands. I fear that responsibility for reclamation of the oil sands lands will end up like the responsibility for cleaning up and decommissioning abandoned and orphan wells in Alberta. Regulation and licensing demanded it, but in the end there was no accountability, and now all Canadians have to pay for that damage to be remediated. And I'm really worried that the same thing might have to happen at Fort McMurray. And I worry that the remediation of the oil sands lands will never occur, leaving Canadians with the cost of cleaning up the largest environmental supersite in the world. Now I am, however, hopeful that the novel will in some way contribute to Alberta Albertans creating a different future for themselves and their provinces. And books like this can help us imagine those futures. And when discussing the novel, you can debate possible scenarios without dragging in political or other ideologies. You can think about them as concepts, as ideas. It's a novel. It's a story. And in this story, First Nations have taken over responsibility for reclamation. And it's working. I really like that. Climate change is a watershed moment for Indigenous peoples. And I'm really glad you brought that into the story.
Well, I don't think you can really tell any story about Alberta and Canada, for that matter, past, present, or future, without bringing in Indigenous peoples. In terms of that aspect of the novel, I'm so grateful to my dear friend Cheryl Chagnon Grey Eyes for helping me guide me through that aspect of the novel, and Cynthia Pipestem as well. Cheryl is originally from Muskeg Lake Cree Nation in Saskatchewan, and Cynthia is from the Tsuut'ina Nation just outside of Calgary. So speaking of past, present, and future, the pandemic is showing us just how vulnerable humanity is to the forces of the natural world. But I think it also shows us that the world can heal. And it seems to me, Bob, that our challenge is to build on that potential rather than revert to old habits in a not too distant future. So I think that, you know, things are fairly grim in watershed, I have to admit. But I think humans are ingenious, they're strong and resilient, and I think there's tremendous hope in that. And I'm curious where you think the hope lies. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, first, there are parallels in the present related to climate effects that could very well create the dystopian elements you pictured in watershed. Well, let's start again with drought. Look at Australia now. The drought has become deeper and more persistent there and in many other places in the world. And in terms of extreme events, all you have to do is point to the thunder and hailstorm that occurred on Saturday, June 3rd. In Calgary, June 13th, it caused more than $1 billion of damage to homes and property in a little over an hour. It's now recognized as the fourth costliest natural disaster in Canada. And interestingly, 6 of the 10 costliest natural disasters in the country have occurred here. Now, as for climate impacts driving involuntary human migration that leads to conflict, the UN estimates that by the time we reach the mid-century and the decade in which you've situated your novel, we should expect 200 to 300 million climate refugees globally. And unlike Willa Van Bruggen and her family, millions and millions of these refugees will not be able to find new beginnings in the countries in which they formerly lived. And then add on top of that political conflict that even in countries that have at last figured out that it's not the cost of climate action that we should be focusing on now, but the growing and rapidly accelerating cost of inaction. So the future you have pictured for the reader in Watershed is hardly far-fetched. The most immediate risk we see is that our society will lapse into some different but functionally unaltered version of what we had before the pandemic, which would be a disaster leading only to the next disasters. The world won't be and it shouldn't be the same again. And we have before us a moment, I think, during which we can turn this great pause into an opportunity for global reset and the emergence of new hope, the kind of hope you end your novel with. But to make that transformation, we have to act on behalf of that hope. The first thing we need to realize is that if we're to address the climate threat in time, we need reconciliation. Meaningful reconciliation, first with one another and at the same time with the earth. And we now know that what Indigenous people have known for thousands of years. We can reduce and moderate the threat of climate disruption by protecting, restoring, and constantly rehabilitating natural system function. And there's enormous power, I think, in realizing this, for it's at the local level, the level in which you've situated your novel, where we live, that we have the most power to affect change and to act most effectively in service of where and how we live and who we love now and in the future. So I think we're at a crossroads. We're running out of time. We need to get on top of this pandemic and get ahead of the climate disruption before it gets ahead of us. But the thing that's really hopeful about this story is we live in one of the places in the world where we can still do that. But to create and have hope, we need to work together, all of us. What we urgently need now is a second, new, and very different enlightenment. But no enlightenment can proceed without a renaissance. And it's worth reminding ourselves, I think, that humanity's first renaissance was born in Italy following an epidemic of the Black Plague in the 14th century. Well, maybe this is a time for another, and we all of us need to be part of that next renaissance, to be that new and wiser beginning, because a better world is possible, and no one's too young or too old to be part of that renaissance. All are invited, and I think through your book, I hope that this will help this renaissance begin.
You're here. All right. So that's, yeah. So Amanda's going to come back on now because that's the end of our program.
Thank you so much, Doreen and Bob. I learned so much. I hope our audience did as well. And we do have some audience questions. So I apologize if I'm mispronouncing this, but we have one from Miriam and Paul. And they say, hi, Bob. The last IPCC report states that there is no statistical increase in global drought or extreme weather with the increase in CO2. Do you think the IPCC got it wrong?
That's a really good question, and it's a really important question. Of course, working with the UN, it's an awkward question. But I will say this, one of the problems with the IPCC is that it's a consensus organization, and all of the research outcomes have to be vetted in the end politically for the executive statements for policymakers. And another problem that the IPCC has is that it's a very complicated process with a long peer review cycle. And oftentimes the data that they're working with is 5 to 10 years old. And they're so careful with it. And many have said that they have underestimated constantly elements of the threat. So it is possible that they are being more cautious than might be justified. But one of the things that we've seen is that almost universally, the situations that we've seen emerge have been at least as bad as the IPCC has projected, and in some cases, in many cases, a lot worse.
We also have a question here from Josepha, and I think this is one that will be relatable to many of us. So you talk about local action. What's the role for municipal governments, and what can I do as an individual to influence change?
Do you want me to take that first?
Go ahead, Bob.
Yeah, okay. All right. This is a very, very important question. And I think the first thing that one has to do is to do whatever they can locally. And when people say, what specifically can I do? Well, there are hundreds of things, and there's websites that show all of those things. But do what brings you joy, what gives you satisfaction, that makes you feel that you're doing something to help. Do that first. Start in your neighborhood. Start in your yard. And then see what's happening in your community, in your municipality. And I think that, again, this is where the power resides. This is where the hope resides. Now, when I look at the multilateral organizational developments for which we are responsible, we try to raise the global ceiling and to direct governments toward appropriate action associated with not just climate change, but the Sustainable Development Goals. Because we can't look at those goals as single items. They are of a piece, and we need to get countries to move toward all of this so that sustainability was in our reach. And we work with national governments so that they can do that for provinces and territories. So we can raise the ceiling, give direction, provide information, science, and as much help as we can. And then that goes down to provinces and especially the municipalities. But I really firmly believe it's at home and in yourself that the greatest power resides in this. And again, do what brings you joy, but do something to act.
And if I could just add, because I did used to work in politics, I worked on Parliament Hill for many years for an MP, and it is really important for all of us to exact change, you know, at every level. So I would definitely encourage people, if they have concerns around water and scarcity and drought and flooding, that that you get in touch with, like I said earlier, you get in touch with your representative and say, this is an important issue for me. What are you doing about it?
And I do just want to call attention to the fact that Josepha said, appreciate you bringing hope into your answer to my question. And I agree with that. I love the idea of bringing joy into action. I think sometimes the stereotype of the environmentalist is sort of the joyless militant, and we want to think of things that are sustainable and more joyful.
Can I speak to that just for 1 second? It's really interesting to see. I live in Canmore, Alberta, and during this great pause, as I call it, you used to see what people are doing with their yards, what they're doing with where they live, and the pleasure they're getting out of it. And the place is really becoming quite extraordinary, and people are learning who their neighbors are. I mean, these things are acts, and the amount of gardens that are growing up, I mean, in places, I mean, we're at 1500 meters, you know, and people have got growing lettuce and everything they can all around here. And it's wonderful to see. And I hope that we can keep that going always.
I think we have a few more questions, but I think we may only have time for one. So we will pass the other ones that didn't get answered on to Bob and Doreen to follow up with if you're able to. But the last question that we'll end with is from Terry. And they say, Bob, I think you mentioned that desalination is damaging to the environment. Can you please explain?
Can you repeat that, please?
Sure. You mentioned that desalinization is damaging to the environment. Can you explain?
Well, desalinization, first of all, it requires an enormous amount of energy. And so depending upon how you're getting that energy, if it's coal-fired, then you're adding, again, one more element to the carbon dioxide problem. And if it's electricity generated from hydropower, it's still a lot of energy. One of the big problems, though, is the composition of seawater. I mean, just think about it. Everything that is soluble in water, and that's just about everything, gets into the ocean. And taking all of that stuff out to make that ocean water fresh water is costly, but you end up with all of that stuff as salts. And they're hard to dispose of, and that's the environmental impact of it. But you're seeing desalinization developing rapidly. People at General Electric keep telling me they're going to get desalination down to 10 cents a cubic meter, and they're going to solve these problems. And maybe by 2058, the years in which we see Doreen's novel, we'll see some pretty interesting developments there.
All right. Well, we're just about at our hour here, so I would like to invite Doreen to conclude by just saying in 1 minute, what do you think that you got from writing your novel and that readers might get from reading it that you would like to share with us?
Okay, well, what I got from writing Watershed was an intense appreciation and respect for glaciers and our water resources. And I'll give you an example from recent times during the pandemic. Our listeners might recall that Gloria Gaynor put out a video in which she was showing us all how to wash our hands properly, and she was singing the song, I Will Survive. All I could think about as I watched that was that she should turn off the damn tap while she's scrubbing and lathering her hands. So you can see the effect that it's had on me, for sure. In terms of readers, well, one reader in Ottawa, Ontario, gave me a great gift. She sent me a message about the book, and she said that Watershed made her extremely grateful for the water in her tap and in the canal outside her window. And honestly, I can't ask for a better review than that. But I would also encourage my readers to read Bob's books, because if there was ever a time for scientists to be our heroes, it's now.
That's lovely. Thank you so much. And Bob, I will give you the final word. So if you had one minute to say what this Watershed moment means to you, what would you say?
Well, building on what Doreen just said, the foundation of my work with the UN is science. And it seems to me that the commandments of science can be reduced to two: to tell the truth and stand up for all humanity and the planet now and generations into the future. Good science involves not just the sharing of knowledge about the world. It is a candle we light when we want to see and be warmed by the truth. And I wish to offer to you, there's probably never been a time in history when it's been more important to understand what science and science fiction are telling us about the dangerous disconnect between our current societal direction and a sustainable future. And like well-developed climate models, cli-fi novels allow us to imagine future worlds based on the one in which we live now. And so doing, books like Watershed allow us to imagine not just the world as it might be, but to imagine also the world we want. So I think you should read this book and imagine that world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, both of you. It's been lovely to have you. And I do apologize for those folks whose questions we were not able to answer, but I did share many of the books that we have available from Bob through our collection at calgarylibrary.ca. We have all of the books that Doreen mentioned, and of course, Watershed as well. So please do go through the chat and look at those. And if you want to learn more, it sounds like that's the best place to start. As I said, this is our very first books and ideas session, but we will be presenting more, so please keep checking back to calgarylibrary.ca for all of our upcoming programs. Thank you so much for joining us, and I hope everyone has a lovely night.
Thank you, Amanda. Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.